Well, video games and a heritage conference. What in the world am I doing here? And especially cruel for the organizers to have me follow the propylaea on the Acropolis. Thank you, I'll get you back from that later on. Appreciate that. I have 20 minutes to convince you that video games belong in a conversation about heritage. So at the end of the 20 minutes, you tell me whether I did that or not. I think I can do it. Let me start out by just saying a few words about ACME. The Australian Centre for the Moving Image is by far the largest museum in the world dedicated to film and television, contemporary video art, and digital culture. We have sister museums around the world that you might be more familiar with, the Cinémathèque Française, the Eye in Amsterdam, TIFF in Toronto, Museum of the Moving Image in New York, the National Media Museum in Bradford. But we are so much larger than they are. We get 1.2 million visitors a year. We're the hub of 14 film festivals. We have two cinemas that run every night of the year except Christmas. And we have a very vibrant set of exhibition programs. We've had a lot of the big exhibitions in our world that travel around that you may have seen in other venues, such as Pixar, Tim Burton, Stanley Kubrick, those kind of levels of exhibitions. And the institution is only 14 years old. In the first decade of its existence, we did a lot of smaller exhibitions that have toured around Australia, but in the last few years, we started creating very large exhibitions that can tour internationally. And that's one of them I want to talk about today. I think I'm the first presenter to talk about a temporary and touring exhibition. I think there may be others during the rest of the conference. The exhibition I'm going to talk about is called Game Masters. And just to start us out a little bit, to give a little bit of context, by a show of hands, how many people here have seen a movie in the last year? I think that's pretty much about 95%, and the other 5% of you are too cynical or bored to raise your hands. Now, how many people have played a video game in the last year? One, two, three, that's pretty good, about 10%. So the movie industry accounts for about $85 billion a year in total global receipts. So it's pretty understandable that nearly 100% of you would have seen a movie. The video game industry accounts for $88 billion of revenue per year. It's larger than the movie industry. Now, you and I are not exactly the perfect demographic for the video game world. And we tend to be a bit more traditional in the way that we absorb our culture. We read books, it's kind of a dying art. But video games, in terms of the demographics of the people that we're trying to attract to our museums, is the biggest thing in the world right now. And this is what our exhibition tried to address. We wanted to reach that group of people out there in the world and both excite their imaginations, but also get them to learn what it took to create a creative sector that only has existed since the 1970s that has grown to be larger than film and cinema in this world. And it was largely created by people who felt a little bit set apart from the society and were looking for a creative outlet but couldn't find it. And typically this is the type of young person that museums want to attract. They're people that are very creative, maybe a little bit out of step with society, but have a lot to offer. And this is who we want to be able to speak to. And this is what this exhibition was primarily aimed at unlocking. The award we won from the Museums Australia was for the large exhibition category. And as a result of this award, we've begun to tour the exhibition internationally. It showed in 2012 at our museum, and 100,000 people came to see it. And it went to Te Papa in New Zealand afterwards. 70,000 people out of a city of only less than 400,000 people came. It went to the Powerhouse Museum in Sydney, and it's opening on the 5th of December at the National Museum of Scotland. So if you are foolish enough to go to Edinburgh in the middle of winter, you can go see this exhibition, which would be very exciting, and we hope it will continue to tour through Europe for a couple of years after that, and then into the US. Now, it is about games, so you can play games in it, but it's not about playing games. It's part of the ambiance is to be able to allow people to experience the entire history of video games in a hands-on fashion, but it really is about the creative process. And this is what we allow it to link into the curriculum. Every venue we've had so far has had massive amounts of school bookings because it does match into the curriculum of people learning about game playing and learning about how that fits into creative processes. And it's been very successful in terms of that and in terms of one other very important thing, and that is to be able to link into large gaming communities in the cities that it travels to and gaming industries. So these same young people that are interested in going to see an exhibition like this are actually creating games. So we have designed the exhibition to be highly localizable. Every country it goes to, in Scotland, it's going to be including large amounts of content from Scottish game designers, UK, broader UK game designers, and as a result, directly involve the community, and it brings in so many more young people as a result of that. I'm going to show a few photos of what it looks like in several different venues that it was in. Obviously, it's a very lively, interactive type of milieu that it's been showcased in. Some of these shots are from Melbourne and some are from Wellington. It's divided into three sections. Now, there are two types of heritage that's at work here, and this is what I need to try to convince you about. In the Arcade Hero section, it features the actual playable machines. Now, most of you are old enough to remember in the 1970s, this is what video games were. Most young people nowadays have absolutely no idea what these are. They're relegated to a few dusty arcades that still exist in the world, but they're largely seen as fossilized elements. To someone that was born after the year 2000, this is a 25,000-year-old fossil. It doesn't make any sense to them. It doesn't mean video games to them. And in fact, as a film center, it's sort of interesting to note that our key target audience was born around the year 2000 or later, and these 13, 14-year-olds, they don't even think a movie that was made before 2000 is something other than a fossilized piece of prehistory. The Tim Burton Batman series from the 1980s and 90s is seen as a curious, it's like something that would be in a glass case, in a display case, whereas the Christopher Nolan Batmans of the 2000s are normal. And this is the challenge that we have. And in one sense, it's a microcosm of the challenge that all of you have as well about how to relate to that great chasm between the young millennials that are coming up now and history itself. Now, arcade games, being the fossils that they are very, very difficult to find nowadays, especially in working condition, and especially in condition that they can be toured all around the world for 5 years. And that they can be bashed on over and over and over again by hundreds of thousands of people seeing this exhibition. We had to go all over the world to try to source these, and this is where the parallels to creating a heritage exhibition start to come into play. We had to go to Wales to find Space Invaders. We went to St. Louis, Missouri, and there were pieces, it was like Frankenstein monster for a lot of these arcade machines, and then we would have to disassemble them and try to find the original pieces and put them together again, and at least put them as much as we could into the vernacular of where they were when they were originally being played. And this, in some sense, comes to the greater essence of why video games as heritage make sense. I'll get to that in a minute. Just a few other examples. As you can see, we were going all over the world for this. We were looking into warehouses where people hadn't touched these things for a decade, and didn't even know how to repair them. And you know, a lot of them were going to end up in the junk heap. One of the stories that's really interesting, one of the great game masters, one of the originators of the entire genre, Toru Iwatani, we were trying to source some of his work, and it turned out that one of them was on a ferry that had plied the waters between England and Ireland, and it was beached on the North Wales coast in 1979 and hadn't been touched since, other than vandals going in. And there was the original game cabinet that was in there, and we were able to pull it off off the ship and restore it to its original form. There's other pieces of hardware that we use in the game as well, some of which have to be reconstituted, some of which we were lucky to find the originals. But the other aspect of this is that Many of you will be involved with issues of digital preservation and the challenges that come up with that as well. And the world that we're dealing with here, since it really evolved in the 1970s and onward, is very much a digital world. And the original generation of games that were on PlayStation 1 game cartridges, they were on floppy disks, they were on hard drives that were encoded in DOS, if any of you remember that from the 1980s. All of this is gone. And you can't play these things on those original platforms anymore, so what happens to them? They fall to dust the same way as a neglected object falls to dust. If it's not properly conserved, if it's not properly restored, if it's not properly cared for and defended and then reinterpreted, it dies. And just because it's dying because of a lack of proper electrical signals, it's not any different than something that's just literally crumbling to dust. There are a lot of movements we're in the world that are trying to address this. We're part of a major worldwide movement called Play It Again, which aims to at least create emulation environments. So environments in new OS X, iOS type of modern environments that opens a window and you can pretend to play a game from the 1970s or 1980s, and it kind of looks like it in this little window. But that's fake. That's not real. It's valuable. It's very important to be able to, for historians and researchers to understand what the game playing experience was like, but that's not real. And what we're missing when we abandon the heritage aspect of video games and just do the recreation of the electronics is we're missing the community element, we're missing the social element, we're missing the essence of the people that would spend all their time playing Dungeons and Dragons or going to the arcade and playing Space Invaders and meeting their friends and communicating on that level. And where is that social memory going? And who is being able to keep that intact? And the fact that it's only 30 or 40 years old really doesn't mean anything anymore, because the pace of change is so fast that we're losing the essence of that as fast as we're losing the ability to recreate what a salon is like in France in the late 19th century. And if we lose that, it doesn't matter how many windows we can open on a computer and play a game, we're going to have lost a little piece of what our own social history was like and what made us the way that we are today. And that's what Game Masters is trying to address, and that's why we're at a heritage conference. Another aspect of what we tried to do is, in recreating the community aspect of this, we wanted to do something that also pretty much no longer exists. If you look in Wikipedia for dance-related video games, there are 87 pages of Wikipedia about this. Probably no one even remembers things like SingStar and Dance Dance anymore. But we recreated these environments, and so the people that were assembling as a group and coming into this arcade environment in the exhibition itself would be able to socialize with each other in the same way that might have happened in the 1980s. And the result was incredible. You would have hundreds of people that were gathered around a stage where people would be singing and dancing and doing moves that were 30 years old, but it looked amazing. And the fact that people were getting so engaged in it, and really young people were doing it that had never seen anything like this before, was especially gratifying to us. The exhibition also dealt with smaller types of games, phones and iPads and things like that. But you can see from this photo that people are really gathered around and they're talking to each other, and it's not an isolating experience. One of the things that was really interesting is talking with the museums that are taking this on tour about how to market this exhibition. And when it went to Te Papa in New Zealand, I met with the director there at the time, Mike Houlihan, and we were talking about what kind of audiences we wanted to try to get in. And I was saying, oh, you know, this is a safe place for people that, your parents and people that don't know much about gaming, that have kids that are always playing games, and they can come and they can try these things and they can appreciate them and they can understand what's so wonderful about them. And Mike said, I don't care about them. I want to get the kids that never leave their room. And it's true. Because if you can get them to come to your museum, and you've engaged with them on this level, and then maybe the following year or the year after, you can offer something else that would speak to them, you've done something that you've never been able to do before. You've been able to get those kids out of their room and come to a museum. And that's been that's something that we think has been really successful. just a few more shots of what the ambiance looked like in the show. Now, we did three other things that accompanied it. We did an exhibition catalog. We also published it as an ebook, and it was more successful as an ebook than a hard copy book, which I think is a bit unique, because usually people like to buy the catalog and take it home and take a look at it. But in this type of subject matter, the ebook worked really well, and we were able to embed extra content into the ebook, which made it more attractive as a result of that. We did a website that's been remade and remixed and mashed up by other venues that have taken the show, and it was meant to be able to be ripped apart and reinvented each way along the way, which is kind of a fun thing to be able to offer other venues to be able to think about that. And we did our own game as well, and we wanted to make a game that was a learning experience. So it's something that a young person or an adult of any type of interaction with games along the way could just grab, and they could learn a little bit about the history of video games and the history of what that hands-on interaction is like and how it has evolved over time, all in one game. And so we had learning objectives for the game itself that were mapped to what we hoped the curriculum for each of the school systems were linking into as well. Again, going back to that idea of unlocking creativity and letting people who are young and creative but don't know how they fit in know that they can do something really amazing with their lives. And that's all I have. I hope I've been able to convince you that video games are a little bit of heritage and that it's something that's worth preserving, even though it's only a 30, 40-year-old movement. Thank you.